Welcome back. Neo-feudalism. I met Norman decades ago at, I think, CalArts. UCLA. Where I soon learned that he was a completely kind of encyclopedic, a knowledge of everything about Los Angeles that Angelenos didn't want to know. It's probably the easiest way of putting it. And I see that here is listed amongst his publications, The History of Forgetting, Los Angeles and the Erasure of Memory, and Freud in Coney Island and Other Tales. I think that leaves out the book that was incredibly important to students at a certain point, I think about 10 or 15 years ago, on special effects.
Yes, Vatican to Vegas.
That?
The Vatican to Vegas, the history of special effects.
And that, for a while, was a kind of a very important book for students. It's a great pleasure to welcome such a pleasurable speaker, Norman.
I don't think I'm going to follow the lecture too religiously. Let me go back to the beginning. There we go. Now, American Tropics. By the way, granular is a strange expression now. Have you encountered that expression? I wrote an essay about it recently. Granular has to do with the obsession with white noise. Culture that's not vertical, but it's filled with interruptions, and that we have to begin to notice the noise rather than. Oh,
here, how's that?
Anyway, I'll go through it, and then I see it in. I'm working on a new book.
Here's my most recent book, just came out this year. And we're going to look at perhaps
Can you try again?
Oh.
It's called The Imaginary 20th Century. In fact, if we could go online, I could show people something of what that looks like anyway. Maybe that would be fun, because it is a kind of architectural object. It has 2,200 images with it. It's a large sort of companion book and online environment. So maybe that's interesting, but it's not what I'm talking about, but it still might be interesting. And the 2,000 images are very rare, very odd. So that means I work in archival things too, and I work in media. I write books that are cultural histories. I'm an expert on what's missing. If you can't find it, I might be able to understand what it is you're hiding, right? Trump was very easy for me because he didn't say anything for months. I only had to listen to what he wasn't saying. I knew his tax problems the moment he didn't talk about them, right? That sort of thing. And my next book is entitled The History of the Present, The Dismantling of the American Psyche. And I've been at it for about 10 years, and the history of the present has a connection to Foucault, the archaeology of knowledge and so on, and It's a kind of archaeological look, but I was trying to understand what has dimmed our bulb so much that it feels so medicated. And I was trying to figure out why does it feel so medicated. I'm just a frantic, neurotic person myself, but I can see it in myself. It's in all of us, I think. And I went over it and over and over it. Went through, I don't know how many documents. My entire house is sort of tilting, I think, because of them. I've been working on Roman arches to sort of hold the books in place because it's gotten to that point where because there's so many of them. And I wanted to find out, of course, when the present started, because the present doesn't start now, right? And I also wanted to find out what are the arcs that determine it. And there's no time to go over all of these, but I came up with four principles, four arcs that seem to be the causal system that best explains what's happened from Brexit to Trump. In fact, when Trump appeared, it was like a triple word score in Scrabble. It was like ridiculous. I've had to readjust the book a little bit. Thankfully, he's going to lose because he's such a son of a bitch. You know, even for him, it's too much, right? I mean, just can't.
Yeah, he's a monster. His father was a monster, too, by the way, in case you're wondering. His father tore down the neighborhood I lived in. Yeah, it's kind of strange. So I remember hearing Trump's name when I was a boy.
Anyway, the first is a simple paradox. So I'll go over these because it's sort of interesting because it took so long to find them, right? It's a paradox about the labor economy. God, these things do really.
I hate these crackers and they're pretty intense actually.
No matter how profitable companies are, there are fewer jobs. The whole labor theory of value seems to have changed. And the process of inequality that goes with it, complicated, but it looks like it's a paradox that's not going to be easily solved. And it's getting worse, and it's infuriating people your age, in particular, understandably. It's infuriating farmers and workers, and it's infuriating white men, most of all, right?
I often start my classes with a statement. Why a kind of apology?
I always say this is a kind of ethical statement. On behalf of my generation, I'd like to apologize for ruining your future. You know, and now these same people, you know, have become so extraordinarily conservative.
But I'd like to also congratulate you in advance
what you're going to have to do. Right? So it's my job to sort of prepare some tools, right, that might help. The first is what will be done about this job problem, and that the inequality is going to increase.
That's pretty obvious, don't you think? Also,
speaking of the United States, certainly, the national government is deeply enfeebled. After nearly 50 years of erosion, we find ourselves inside a constitutional crisis, probably more severe than at any time since the Civil War. It'd take a long time to explain it. A constitutional crisis means you can't pass any laws. That's, leaving aside the ethics of who's running the government, it's extraordinary. And then also the way that power circulates has utterly changed. That's curious. From top to bottom, across continents, we have descended into what I call an urban industrial feudalism, particularly in the United States. And then, of course, I've had to go over every form of feudalism that ever existed. It's just relentless. There are so many. There must be about 50 at least. And it turns out every country has a feudal condition
almost built into them, like a chronic allergy or something like that. And something about globalism in the last 40 years has made this grow to a degree that it's infected the national governments of many countries that are supposed to be more stable than that. When was the last time that Scotland demanded to leave its connection with Britain? Was that the 18th century? I mean, it's quite amazing. Things are happening. But
we can't discuss that too much. It's one of the issues, clearly. And then
also we see a steady, relentless dismantling of public confidence. Really, really powerful. And it's strange. It takes on strange directions. And it's the Trump and Brexit story this year. But next year it'll be something else. You don't think it's going to go away, do you? Because Brexit is or isn't solving something. That energy is still there, isn't it? And it's complicated. It's complicated by many, many areas. But I can't summarize that in 5 minutes. Even though I speak fast because I'm from Brooklyn originally, I can't do it all. So I need to narrow these down to one simple story. Because a lecture should at least have a trajectory like a story. And because Mark is the greatest storyteller I've ever heard, you know, so I have to at least try to match, right, the simple jovial erudition, right, of what he does, you know. Part of it is this granular or sideways version of things. It's obviously a dialectical materialist problem, you know, like a sort of Marxist dialectic, but it seems like it's moving sideways or backwards. It doesn't seem to have the same dynamic, and yet it has all of the functional parts that people identify as a class issue and so on. So I'll read this section here. The history of our present began approximately in 1973. That's the year. It keeps reappearing. It's like a haunted year. It's like a cursed year, but also a funny year. And I've interviewed myself because I go back to 1973, and I knew nothing of what was going on. I was a complete moron. I was a leftist looking at all the wrong, I was looking down the wrong hole, right, over and over again. But the phenomena of 1973 do seem to be the prologue to what we call globalism. And it turns out globalism is kind of a misnomer, because globalism seems to maybe make sure that all over London you can get a latte for the first time, right? And all over, I don't know, Bangladesh you could probably get a latte too, for all I know. But it's regionalized and fractionalized things. It hasn't made us global. We're not really global. If we were global, we wouldn't be in this place, would we? And the EU wouldn't be in trouble, would it? Right? Something's happened, yes? So that became the pursuit, right? And I'm trying to understand this anyway. So I'll deal with one word first. The history of one word. We'll travel to one word. Is that okay? Because I started to use the word entropy, and then I discovered to my horror that it's more than a word. It's a problem, because it goes back and back and back. And in the early 70s. Did any of you read anything by Claude Levi-Strauss? I have to say I was never particularly overwhelmed by Levi-Strauss, but I admired his greatness or whatever. But he wasn't one of the people I borrowed from, but now I realize I'm bumping into him, I have no choice. He was perhaps one of the most influential theorists, he may have been the most influential theorist in the United States around 1970. Unlike many writers who become halcyon figures, the uses of his work was seemingly everywhere and assumed a life far beyond himself. One might say that he was greatly, affectionately, and widely misunderstood. That's always a sign of it, right? And we have other applications that his theory connect to, like Durkheim, Mauss, and even, of course, the era where people were talking about Freud and Marx and Saussure and Jacobson and so on. It was a new system of encoding culture. And that system was, of course, identified with the term structuralism. Then they went to post-structuralism, and then we just went to whatever granular mess we're in now, right? That's something like that. And there are all these homeostatic aspects to his theory. I know, I don't think I'll do that. The search for common linguistic mythemes across cultures. But there was another side to Levi-Strauss's work, quite the reverse, that I think is all right for our story. It works very well for our story. He writes about noisy, irascible codes. The decay of meaning was very interesting for him as an engine for improvisation. And one of the terms he used was bricolage, which became very, very sexy back in the day. Let's say 70s, I think it's fair to say. Among his most admired works was something called Tris Tropiques,
which is rather hard to translate. Sad Tropics, that doesn't sound right at all, right? He means it quite different. In fact, it was a very scholarly memoir about his youthful experience working mostly in Brazil, but elsewhere, and going through the jungle and meeting people. The mood is very lush, it's open-ended. It's as if Conrad were writing anthropology. It's a very unusual book. And at the time he wrote it, in 54, 55, he was certain his career in the university was over. He was sure he'd never be an anthropologist. I don't know what he thought, he was going to be a mailman, you know, something. His personal life was equally a mess, a divorce and everything else. So he wrote this book, Tres Tropiques, in a discursive voice that crisscrossed very oddly. And then the irony, which is what often happens for some strange reason, the book was so odd that it made him very famous. And then, of course, his career was never affected again, and he was a heroically successful, very, very successful character after that. So it relaunched his career. That's it. And then I like these scholarly memoirs. It's very good for the kind of research on the present because it's about scholars disagreeing with themselves. I've decided to find books where scholars change their mind and get angry at themselves. But that's another subject. But it tells you things about the moment. It's a subjunctive tense, you might say. And he's trying to match in this book his mission in life. He had decided to become an anthropologist, partly because he was living in, he'd been living in New York during the war, and he met anthropologists, and he became committed to this profession. New York had a strange influence on him. And then also to match that with the catastrophes in Europe, and then 6 years in New York, and then, unlike his other works, it doesn't have a stable hermeneutics, this book. So it's odd. He listens, he looks. He's looking more for noise instead of a meta-system. It's an interesting search. And that fits up. It's a very granular book then, isn't it? So I liked it. I decided to take that one. Even his language is double. It's filled with entendres. He gives the word tropics. Here's our problem, right, for the translation. Literally, different meanings, right? The tropics were not simply a region below the equator. They were play on words, right? Tropics suggested entropy, and that becomes an issue, right? In the spirit of what he found in the Brazilian jungle, he found entropic waste on the forest floor. It sparked evolution. He got very excited about this. I mean, there is a kind of primitive side to him in this book, I think, but he was still a scholar. Tropics also meant the reordering of his internal sense of decay. So it's almost like this word had this double and triple meaning for him. And then he used the term entropy other times, and I think that becomes a useful term for us, at least for me, to take you into feudalism somehow. I think entropy also was for him the end of what they were called the Western hegemony, because of post-colonialism, because of the collapse after the war, and so on. So it has this meaning that's strange. He narrates the story almost like a movie travelogue. It's very, I've gotten to really like this book a lot, obviously. First, you can see the camera POV in Brazil in the 30s, then the fall of Paris, then the New York version, and then finally back to Paris, where he notices that Paris was turning too Americanized, right? There's a degree zero irony in the work and so on. I'll read one paragraph, right? And then we'll go from there. Taken as a whole, even civilization is a prodigious, overcomplicated mechanism. It would be tempting to see this machine as our best hope of survival. The machine itself produces what physicists call entropy. Ah, see, so now that's how I got stuck with this. Also, I have to say the computer's amazing. I mean, it's a brain dead instrument, but you type in entropy and it goes to 1,000 pages and finds it for you. So you can't resist it. I've done it with Moby Dick. It's kind of amazing. Went in and out Moby Dick in about 4 minutes, you know, asking questions. It's funny. It's changing how one researches. Anyway, entropy, inertia, that is to say, through entropy, every scrap of conversation, every line set in type establishes a communication between two interlocutors. These collapse what previously had been two separate planes. It creates a discipline that devotes itself to the study of disintegration in its most evolved form. It's interesting. So this waste and disintegration he saw as extremely productive. And the book was hugely, hugely popular, right? And all his work was extraordinary. By disintegration, he meant something like white noise. I'm very interested in white noise these days, even though I'm a musical idiot. But I work with musicians a lot where I teach. So they forgive me being a musical idiot. I write about it. I even write about white noise. It's interesting. It's the noise we leave out, right? And it turns out our culture seems to have a lot of white noise that's destroying us somehow. It's damaging us. And Brexit sort of had a lot of white noise that people didn't notice, I guess. Or maybe I'm wrong. We'll talk, right? Native cultures in America were especially attuned to this noise, he discovered. They understood the analogs of time. And then in 62, he wrote another book where he talks about the savage mind. It's a title. It was his primer in many ways, his primer. And it was really adored when it was translated in 66, which means that in the early 70s, it was widely known. Then in the 60s and 70s, something like a savage mind model about entropy was applied to other fields. And then you really begin to see this problem emerge from everywhere, from Thomas Pynchon to Stephen Hawking, who was quite convinced that the theories of entropy explain parts of how physics, astrophysics work, especially black holes, so on. It's interesting. So maybe that word can be a clue, right? How the word changes meaning maybe would tell us something of how the present evolved. And I guess I better tell you what I discovered about entropy, being not only a musical idiot, but also a scientific idiot. Yeah, I mean, I remember pithing the brain of, I remember pithing the brain of a frog in high school, and that was the last scientific thing I actually did. And the frog, I was the son of a kosher butcher, so the frog
looked like something you wouldn't sell in the store, but I couldn't make sense of it beyond that. But still, the second law of thermodynamics was mostly established, I guess, in the 19th century. And what's curious about it is that it has two features, and I think that's a clue. That's a clue to the story to get us sort of somewhere. One is that entropy in simple terms, entropy, I guess, is the cooling fact. When something is hot, it turns cool, right? But it's very, very complicated. The formulas completely overwhelmed me. When I looked through, I just realized I was lost. I mean, I had 16 letters attached to with a algebra. Have you ever seen what those formulas look like? Maybe you can figure them out. I have a scientist living next door to me, so to speak, where I teach, and he just smiles. It's like easy for him, and it doesn't help me, you know? But the first was that it's about decay and waste. The second is that it's dynamic and frantic, and it always leads to a closed system. So one is seemingly very dynamic in a weird way, because the system is closed anyway. And another is, of course, a mess, right? And so I went then from there, and I have some other examples of how it's been applied. It's been used in cybernetics. It's been used in game theory, black hole theory, cosmic microwaves, the Big Bang. It was used in theories about global warming. It's everywhere. When you start doing a search with the word entropy, it's like 4 o'clock in the morning and you haven't even barely started. But what's interesting about it is other uses and also other issues. For example, a curious fact that struck me about this period when the word caught on so much was that as of 1975, an odd fact, 20% of Americans apparently were using antidepressants. And I thought, no, that's entropy. There's a medical form of entropy. So this whole pharmacological version of Alzheimer's began to think that it's a state of mind and a state of being. And I guess that's what they're reaching for. Norbert Wiener, who is a very important figure, he invented cybernetics, and he was very important for the
military wing of capitalism and other areas as well. The cyborg, that's his fault, right? He invents these terms.
He felt that entropy was such a bad sign. It was such an evil thing. It was proof that nature was not up to the virtues that the human being needed, and therefore you needed information systems and feedback loops to apply to fix nature. This is a true mid-century modernist madness, right? I write a History of Forgetting, I write about that, because it gave excuses to violate the planet and the skin of the earth. So in a strange way, there was a 50s version of entropy that even was identified with the atomic bomb. The atomic bomb was bad entropy. It sounds like it would be, right? And that the Soviets were entropic, but we weren't, you know? So it's strange. So we have a nice baseline to work from. And then come these changes. Rudolf Arnheim, if you know who he was, he's a famous art historian. He starts to use the term as order in disorder, as a model for what was interesting about modernism, modern art. So suddenly entropy is more positive. This is in the early 70s. Oh no, 61, earlier than that, right? Robert Smithson, do any of you know who he is? Was? Big deal, yes? Quite important and remarkable figure. And not only that, an interesting writer, as well as being Robert Smithson, it's an extra bonus, a value added. He was obsessed with entropy. He writes about it a lot. And he wrote a special manifesto on it in 1966. He identifies it with the hypnotic state of mechanism. And then he goes on and on about how horrible it is in many ways. Let me see if I can find one of his nice quotes here. He identifies it with the suburbs and so forth, the slurbs, he calls them, right? And that the stillness of suburban mid-century modernist life was entropic in a way, but that there was a good entropy that could be done by using sculpture and space in a different way. So it was a very, very important problem, right? The most denigrated architecture of Park Avenue, known as cold glass boxes. Let's see, human car ride. No, I had this wonderful quote, and I thought I had it here. I thought I typed it down. Oh, the slurbs, urban sprawl, and the infinite number of housing developments of the post-war boom have contributed to the architecture of entropy. So he feels that there's good and bad entropy. Now we're beginning to see a transition somewhere in the course of the mid-60s and late 60s. And it turns out there was a crisis in the late 60s that may have had an effect on why people started to begin to remodel in this aesthetic way. And I'm pretty sure there's a connection.
So thoroughly in the West, in Europe and the United States, that there was nervousness that capital wouldn't be able to keep going properly. And they had an agreement at the end of the Second World War called Bretton Woods, which was very, very stable in a way, but didn't seem to be expansive enough. And so the feeling was that they needed to open up to what one would say a more frantically entropic system, and assume that if they let things open out much more, it would simply find its own order. So some kind of strange connection between capitalism, the invisible hand, and entropy began to evolve. And then by 1971 to 73, they changed the economic system, Nixon did. He ended the Bretton Woods agreements, and he opened out ways for capital to expand in a much more unregulated fashion. Without that process, we wouldn't have had globalism. And so it's interesting, in the early 70s, there's this redefinition of all that. And I think something strange happens in the 70s where there's an ethic about expansion and deregulation. And that's partly why the internet is so completely unpatrolled. It was given literally a free hand. So we have this interesting decade. I'm obsessed with it. And I was looking for people who would fit into this particular story. So For example, Thomas Pynchon. Thomas Pynchon. No, right? Thomas Pynchon, novelist.
Gravity's Rainbow, so on. Well, whatever. I mean, I'm not sure where I stand and how much I admire, don't admire him, but the point is he's very, very important, and he was obsessed with his version of entropy and its relationship to literature and its relationship to where the world was going. And that makes it interesting, because now we've gone from Smithson to scientists to Stephen Hawking to Thomas Pynchon. It's starting to get interesting, I think. I realized I had walked into a tremendously big hole. It's a stupid idea. I should have left the word entropy out of the book and altogether. But anyway, here's some of the lines. The whole structure shivered into a disarray of discrete and meaningless signals, a kind of feedback. And then he indicates that he hates what Norbert Wiener wrote, and he's determined to attack Norbert Wiener, and that this entropy system is Norbert Wiener himself, that Norbert Wiener and the monsters like him are the entropic figures. And he has a whole story with the title Entropy. So I have no way around this, right? And there are a lot of there's a lot of science fiction talking about atomic bombs and entropy and so on in the course of the 50s and 60s. And then he writes other novels about it also. He wrote a novel called The Crying of Lot 49 in the mid-60s, and that also uses the word entropy all the time. And then Gravity's Rainbow, he felt the entire structure of the novel was living proof that the second law of thermodynamics could become literature. So it's interesting, but I'm quite convinced that what they're responding to is this transition in the global economy, this transition in the way power operated, and that this transition was difficult to understand at first. I mean, I remember myself in the early 70s worrying about Nixon, worrying about all sorts of vertical problems, about feudalism, about fascism coming in America. I didn't keep track of any of this stuff. I didn't keep track of container ships coming in. I didn't know that would matter. Why should it matter that there are container ships coming in? I didn't think it was bad that China would be opened. It seemed like that was a good thing. Why shouldn't it be open? One time my brother-in-law in those years took some of my money and invested it in the stock, and it started to make money, so I immediately sold the stock because it was entrepreneurially impossible for me to keep track of how to make money, right? And then I asked him finally what was in this stock. And he said, oh, it was Bunkerimo. I said, what are they doing that they're making so much money? And he said, oh, they're digitizing the banking industry. I remember saying to him, does that matter? I mean, so why should it matter if it's digital or if it's just numbers on a piece of paper? It didn't. So I was invested in the birth of globalism and didn't know it. So it's very, very easy as a warning when you deal with issues like entropy and these terms to understand that we're probably not looking in the right direction. And culturally, we're probably not sure how to handle this. And we're in a kind of crisis of another sort. We're in a transition that's very, very fast and powerful. In the 70s, didn't seem as powerful, but it was, right? Anyway, I'll read a little bit about the feudalism side, right? So I think entropy is a culture response to the end of the economic system that followed the Second World War and its replacement by a cultural and economic system that's very similar to a kind of urban industrial feudalism, which is a weird thing to imagine. Because it's not a feudalism like Robin Hood walking in tights with a bow and arrow. It's something quite different. And the United States, for example, has almost no history of feudalism until really the 1880s. Though they had a few curious things that happened in the 18th century. That they couldn't get people to Georgia. No one wanted to go to Georgia. Would you want to go to Georgia in the 18th century? Swampland. So they set up a system where you could indenture yourself for 6 years, and that way it would pay for your trip.
And the only way they could indenture you was by bringing back the old feudal laws and applying them to the colonies. So there actually is what they call belated feudalism inside the legal system of the United States. So we have all these oddities, but what generated that change? What made that happen? And how does it actually operate is of course of great importance, right? To architects, to writers, to everybody. And now to politicians as well. So I have all these different, I went through Walt Whitman, I went through Tocqueville, right? And then I realized that I had the wrong date. This entropy thing, it wasn't what I thought. It wasn't feudalism like, I don't know, feudal lords. It was when it was mixed. Apparently, it works like this. Feudalism, I know I should read my notes, but I'm looking at you. I'm doing okay, right? I'm making sense? It's good enough, right? So that feudalism is an oligarchical system, yes? I mean, I could read it and try to look solemn, but there's no point. This is a fairly friendly environment, right? Feudalism is an oligarchical condition, not even a system. And it tends to be very, very withering to the state. It tends to have a very weak state system. It makes it legally impossible or even legally discouraged that this oligarchy pay taxes. This is 18th century system, even earlier than that. And then it tends to have tremendous difficulty in master planning. It has a very, very strange relationship to culture. It slows down cultural work a lot. And it fractionalizes. In Germany, when the feudal system went through the transitions in the 1400s, 1500s, 1600s, there was at the time 300 Germanies. It's really crazy. I mean, the children kept fractioning out their parents' estates, but they weren't estates, they were countries. And then finally, it was only 30 Germanies, that sort of thing. And so this fractioning out also tends to bring atavistic process, a lot of religious wars, and a lot of failed states, and a lot of blurry boundaries. And also a very, very curious part of this story, which is why I think people found entropy positive, is that this is a literary thinking. This isn't a scientific thinking. History is often a very literary art. It's actually intelligent guesswork, but it's very close to writing fiction. You feel that often. But another curious quality about feudalism, which may be an interesting answer, is that it's like a tattered sweater. And I'm talking about feudalism in Brazil, feudalism in Egypt, feudalism in Japan. It's just, oh God, there's so many versions. What I mean by tattered sweater is that it creates voids. These voids could be a failed country, but there could also be another kind of void. And so apparently the new theories are that capitalism didn't come on the failures of feudalism. The new theory is that feudalism incubated capitalism itself, which is kind of amazing. But then I found, oh, of course you would think that way because we're into the feudal way of thinking. In other words, everyone's looking for the noisy exceptions. So now the noisy exceptions add up to the idea that, for example, right? A lot of people say, well, capitalism comes out of cities. Well, one theory that has become widely discussed recently is that in the 1400s, after the Black Death, they started to develop surpluses in England again because labor was short, but the productivity was growing. But because the system had collapsed in a lot of ways, a lot of these former serfs now had, of course, their own deals. They cut special deals, and they wanted the surplus. So the arguments over the surplus and how to organize it and the peasant assemblies that were used to organize it, one theory is that that was the basis of what transferred capitalism to the 16th century, not the cities, but the peasants in the countryside in this sort of semi-feudal system. And one other theory is that these feudal assemblies may have been the basis of what was shipped off to the New World and may have been the basis of democracy or something. It's quite ridiculous. But yeah, it looks like what we're doing is
like these obsession with entropy, we're starting to think in a very granulated way. It's almost like you take your camera, right? You position it, and then you get interested in the dust in the lens. Then you notice the dust in the lens has something to do with the climate. Then you become very, very nano logic, and you get lost in a dissolve. I know you're smiling because it's the way we think now. So obviously they would, of course, have found this. Do you understand? So everywhere I'm going, I'm finding cultural examples of people noticing the granular or fractured nature of things, I think because of the fractured nature of our entire world economy. I'm pretty sure. Because it's a big thing. It's a big thing. It's changed my life. And it's changing your lives a lot, yes? I love when they say gig economy, like that's a good thing. You work 20 hours a week, you have to be around for 80 hours available, you get no money, no future, right? You get a 3-month job, you get a bad contract. Life is shit, right? I mean, my son is working for the television industry. He has to change his job every 4 months. You know, I mean, it's ridiculous. But it's how it is, and it's part of this fracturing process. So it appears that it's going to keep growing and evolving, but it does have these incubational possibilities. It can incubate a Trump, who has taken full advantage of all of these holes, and he's proud of it, right? In addition to groping women, he likes to grope taxes, tax things, and the growth of tax havens and so on, all this, there's a lot of secrecy connected with feudalism, with feudal systems too. You begin to see the patterns over and over and over again, and it's very, very layered. So feudalism can coexist with capitalism quite well until it crashes, right? Because eventually they become an unstable alliance and then it crashes. So we're beginning to see, I think, since 2008, the crash moment, right? But apparently, there is a third law of entropy, a third version. The third version is when the closed system begins to actually melt. I don't know if that happens out in space, but it happens here in the world. So I'm going on and on, going over all these examples, and it's very, very clear that we have achieved a new condition that's so layered and so similar to the spirit, right, of a kind of feudal ancien regime. I find this, I'll invent stories for it. I tried to study what kind of novels go with this sort of condition, and I have. Now this is a picaresque novel, you could look at it. We'll see if it comes up in questions. Right? It has 2,000 images with it. It has a kind of disparate archival quality, right? And I've gone over picaresque fiction from the 16th century onward, and it had one quality that seemed to fit this era. In particular, the lead characters always knew one thing about the future. It was always going to get worse. And in other words, Don Quixote is not a picaresque character, but Sancho is most certainly a picaresque character. Yes, Sancho. Well, Sancho, do you think he's crazy? And he said, did you say dinner? Not crazy. I mean, he's a rogue, he's a finesse, he finesses, he does this and that, the other thing. And there's more of these. And finally, as I mentioned in a talk the other day, we got one of these picaresque swindler finaglers running for president in the United States. It's almost like the small version of capitalism, like the small C, crossed over into the big P of politics. But Trump is a very picaresque character. He's like, no empathy, weirdly comic. There's something very funny about Trump. I mean, he's funny. Do you find him funny? He's ridiculous, right? I mean, he'll be funnier when he's gone, but he's funny. He still is funny. So I'm also interested in what aspects of art production would work for this new kind of economy. I'm wondering how should we reinvent cities? So, for example, I was given a very special tour by someone who's here. I saw London Fields. It didn't seem like much. It was just expensive bread and
It's a fancy walk in a meadow, and I realized I was being shown, right? I'm looking at Jasper, who showed me that I was being shown a new kind of urban phenomenon that exists all over the Western world, these kind of townships, these little townships. They're not actually just gentrification, there's something else. And I'm starting to study those, and I realize that's a connection also. Because what happens in the feudal condition is it empowers cities enormously, because the nation state gets so weak. Cities become almost like kingdoms, and inside these kingdoms, little townships develop. And it's very clear that something of the urban plans that are developing are also a response to this. It's very obvious. We may not like it, but we have a civilization. We may not want to think it's civilized, but it's very, very thorough. But one thing is certain, it's a void and an interregnum at the same time, and it's going to deeply affect your life. Because I think it looks to me like it's a 20-year cycle, easily, that we're going to face. And that 2008 wasn't a recession, it was actually an event that suggested changes. And these changes are going to be extremely important for architecture, you can imagine, right? Basically, I wouldn't say architecture is a profession of courtiers, but it has a little of that quality that you're always sort of watching where things are coming and going. It's also going to affect how media works. It's going to affect how different forms of entertainment work. It's going to affect, obviously, how power works, and it's creating constitutional crises all over the world, right? And so I think the next 10 or 20 years will tell us a lot more, and maybe we'll know what the extra law of entropy might be, and then we'll see other responses with it. I think I could go on, but I have a feeling that I must have generated something that could bring questions. Can we start a discussion, right? Would that be a good idea? We'll pretend I ended with some flourish, but let's end with a flourish together. Is that all right? And I know I have this paper I could have read, but I think you get the spirit of the connections, and I'm looking at your faces, and I think I'm communicating well enough that we can talk from here. And there's a lot more information I can give you. You can ask questions, make observations. There are obviously visual references. There might be structure and architectural references. And then, of course, I know that Mark has to get the microphone. Oi, yes.
I've said some things that interest him. Am I correct?
Yes.
I'm trying to interest people. I'm trying to start a conversation. Not simply deliver a lecture.
Okay. Thanks very much. And it did seem actually a very effective way of, like, somehow lecturing and not quite lecturing.
I mean, I give a granular version of lecture, but in looking at everyone and understanding that they've had a long day and a long week, that I thought I would try to communicate with them, right?
Yeah.
So that we can begin a discussion, and knowing that we will have a long and friendly chat, I thought chatting was the best way, right?
I suppose I was thinking of one area which you didn't explicitly kind of touch on, and it exists as quite a kind of formal issue, but it's the way in which your argument is in many ways reflected by the kind of developing question of law. That is to say that, you know, what we know about, say, feudal Europe is that it was very often the case that people were under a set of competing jurisdictions.
Yes.
You could, for example, be under the rule of your city, under the rule of an aristocratic family in the form of like a duchy or whatever, and in the form of the then universal church through kind of canon law. And in many ways, the supersession, which sort of parallels the beginnings of capitalism, is that capitalism is then organized into national capitalisms, each of which, in which, like, the legal system is the sovereign. Now, I mean, it seems to me one of the consequences of what you're talking about from, say, 73 is that the opening to a much deeper and more intense form of global trading,
yes,
kind of muddles all that up. The question of law.
First of all, just as a point, feudalism tends to never remove laws. It just makes them unworkable. So there's a history that the feudal condition has many laws, and it's entirely right about the overlapping. I mean, but would you say in 73, we had a more organized system of law than we have now?
Laws were certainly more organized around national systems of law, which, as it were, declared sovereignty. I mean, one thing, yeah, you can't imagine, say from the point of view of 73, and I say this, I mean, it's the other side as well, the side that's trying to kind of protest, not protest, but to act against this. But with the rise of something like the International Criminal Court, you can have, I mean, we had a very famous example in this country where when Pinochet was here, as a sort of guest of, yes, Margaret Thatcher. At the same time, this magistrate in Spain said, you know, issued a warrant for his arrest, quite rightly, and delivered it to the English, like to deport Pinochet to Spanish jurisdiction. And, you know, it took a long time,
yeah,
to get him back to Chile in one piece for the authorities. Yeah. And he was indeed taken into custody. I mean, the look of outrage and horror and bafflement on Thatcher's face was perfectly astonishing. So, you know, it's that everyone is dealing now.
Different layers. The philosopher Agamben uses an old Roman term, and that comes to the Renaissance. He uses the term states of exception. And I think he's on to, I don't know whether you need Roman law to do it. I think your example is more interesting. That this condition, whatever you want to call it, ancien regime, has so many states of exception because the legal systems conflict with each other, that eventually the sheer erosion of them creates a level of corruption that becomes almost astonishing. And we finally have a presidential candidate in the United States seems to commit every corruption, right? That these layers of laws can do. And in the United States, for example, you can't get an abortion in Mississippi. That's strange because it's the law of the land. The Supreme Court said you have to be able to get an abortion in Mississippi. Mississippi said, excuse me, pardon me, let's be precise, right? we're Mississippi, we just don't allow any doctor to perform an abortion. If you want to have an abortion, you can have one, but you can't have one with the doctor. And they simply stopped it. Whereas now 30, 40 years ago, the federal government stepped in and say, excuse me, but this is a vertical system of law, but the federal government didn't. And there are many, many cases increasingly where the federal government used to step in and isn't. So exactly what you're saying is emerging more and more. And then the World Bank developed around the same time, and look how well they're doing. it's a layered mess. So everything you talk about is absolutely right. I'm gonna have to read legal books for the next year. But yes, the whole system of law, I'm gonna have to find some smart lawyers who can and interview them. I think I can't spend another 2 years. I mean, I spent like 4 weeks just in entropy, right? These problems are huge because this is a very large phenomenon, but it's absolutely correct. The legal system, I mean, the last House of Representatives, right, that met in 2012 was the 2012 Congress. They passed fewer laws than were passed in the 1790s. I mean, they passed something like 2% of the bills that were put forward. And that's so insane, right? But then at the same time, it's all about these conflicting issues you're talking about. Apparently when you don't have a vertical system, you have these oligarchical factors, exactly what you're saying happens.
Well, I agree with you. I mean, that to find the right evidence is actually a real kind of issue. So when it comes to law, I mean, I think the person to look at is actually, what was his name, Pope John Paul, the Polish Pope.
I mean, what was only about the United States, right?
He tried to bring back the jurisdiction of canon law, which had pretty much, even in Catholic countries, was, you know, done and gone pretty much in the sort of 18th, 19th century. So he had, I mean, there was a legal document which became important in France, where a French priest was on trial for, surprise, sexual abuse. The judge subpoenaed the bishop to appear.
Yes.
The judge comes, and the bishop comes, and the judge starts cross-questioning him about what he did or didn't know.
Yes.
About this priest. The bishop declined to answer. And quite rightly, the judge sends him to jail for contempt of court. Meanwhile, in the Vatican, a bishop writes a letter to him saying, "You are like one of the martyrs of the early church. Your refusal to sort of kowtow to a civilian court is fantastic." He didn't like to send it until he actually showed it to the Pope to get his permission. And the Pope said, "That's such a great letter, it goes out to every bishop in the world." So, you know, you find these strange, bizarre attempts to derogate from what people otherwise thought was a settled system, the national judiciary system. And indeed, the papal nuncio to Britain said very proudly that canon law had actually tried some priests in Rome for child abuse. However, they all got off by pleading the fact that they did it because they were paedophiles. And this was
fact. They couldn't control
to excuse them.
It's just locker room talk.
Yes.
Yeah. This, by the way, part of the website novel of the imaginary 20th century. It's four tiers, different chapters, and about 300 illustrations and voiceovers and so on to go with it. And it's a story about an archival story about a man who works for oligarchs. And his job is that he erases crimes that are embarrassing to them over a period of 50 years in Los Angeles. And then he's obsessed with his niece in an interesting way, but doesn't act on it, but he obviously is upset. The obsession is what it is. And she has a curious life because she becomes a kind of legend for various reasons. In 1901, she actually apparently selected four men to seduce her. They traveled across Europe to Southern California to live with her, and each of them had to tell her in their own way what the next century was going to be. And she would listen to Scheherazade in the verse. And then other things happened, and then she shot a man in 1908. There was also an article written about her in 1913 by this strange philosopher who was very, very nihilistic. He would spend his weekends with a gun at his table, and his friends would wonder, and then finally blew his brains out. But in the meantime, he wrote this article where he calls her the bride stripped bare. And Duchamp read the article, was very impressed, and he made a great class. So she's kind of a legend. And in 1917, for reasons that are difficult to quite understand, this man who had all of these rather peculiar historical espionage issues to deal with makes a giant archive about his niece of 2,200 images. And it's called the Imaginary 20th Century for various reasons, and it's kind of a machine thing. He has a machine. He's able to operate almost with pulleys and have things come at him and move around and so on. And then in 2004, it was discovered again. And then Margo Bistis and I were given these 300 boxes to take apart and try to see what the archive was. And then finally it was clear that it did have a story. So we have the story here, but the story, of course, was his story. We don't need to tell. So there has to be a print book to explain what's left out, right? So that's what it is.
Patrick.
And that was because Patrick was looking at this. I thought I'm explaining it for you.
Thanks a lot.
So my belief is that we need an either and form of work to accommodate to this for the sake of discussion today, this feudalistic granular world requires new forms, and I think no ebooks, you must have, each medium has to work together in concept. So I'm trying to invent forms of storytelling that match what I just talked about. It's hard to summarize your work. Much easier to talk about feudalism than talk about yourself.
So, my question is the status of your way of developing a, let's say, literary approach to the century, to current times, about the current socioeconomic conditions, and, you know, how does that sit with or relate with, let's say, a more, and you said it's not science, it's not history of, it's not economic history, or it's not economic theory informed economic and social history. But what I find interesting about it, I'm offering that rather than a question, or you can come back to me, that what you might be doing, I find it stimulating. For me, it's a kind of play of free association, of making comparisons back in history, concepts which are floating around, cybernetics, entropy, necroentropy, and a description of the contemporary across different domains, looking at novels. So is that perhaps some kind of proto-historiography which should stimulate historians to look for and systematize and build theories?
I'm a historian by training, and that is plain, but I've been running barefoot for a long time. So historians get scared shitless sometimes when I think. But no, I remember one person saying they wanted to do a dissertation based on my writing. And their advisor said, "Oh, how wonderful you're working with Norman." He said, "But remember one thing: if
you write like him, you'll never have a job."
He said, and he came back. He said, "I'll never have a job. What should I do?" He said, "Don't write like me."
And then that was the end of that relationship. You know, but apparently, what's happening lately is that this strange crossover that I've been doing so comfortably. About history of forgetting and erasure and architecture that way and work on in different fields is beginning to make some sense, because I think what I almost noticed is now really here. I've been writing about terms like electronic baroque, which is obviously another example of this, and I've been moving in that direction, responding to it, and only now, by forcing myself back to being a historian of the present, have I begun to see these connections. And that they are structural, they are cultural. There's a reason why stream of consciousness fiction happens around 1910 to 1920. There's a reason why a minimalism in the 60s found its way into the computer world of the 1970s and 80s. These reasons are not scientifically clear. They have a kind of echo. They're like vibrations, you might say. But they're interesting to look at, and they do help explain the what definitely is needed desperately now, which is a much more dialectical, transformative, and playful way to work. So I'm offering as many playful ways as I can. I think it's needed. I think, what was it, Tristan Tzara said, the world needs an operation. Well, the world needs something like an operation again, I suppose, right? If that makes sense. So it's intentional and playful, but there is actually a 12 layers deep historical method to it. So you're quite right.
But it's not something where you can make actionable claims.
Well,
so it's stirring others to see.
Let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Okay. The question would be, if there is, I use the term social imaginary a bit differently than Castellanos did and others, but I found my own sort of Norman way to say, but boiling it down, if there is an accepted belief, right, but the belief is in the event that never happened, and someone runs for office based on that belief, or someone sells a product based on that belief, or someone kills someone because of that belief, is that belief not even more solid than a bridge? Because nothing can knock it down. In other words, I'm an expert on what people misunderstand, but this misunderstanding is sort of real, isn't it?
I mean, you don't know, what I feel is you could leave it to your readers to see, to
yes,
get excited and see positive vibrations, or see it as a critique and something to fight, even,
yes,
even that open, and
yes,
just your whole self-depreciating form of presentation means I'm saying this is something which stimulate but doesn't claim and doesn't direct.
I try not to have any high moral ground. When I'm asked to write articles about things or do journalism, which I do occasionally,
yeah,
I always have one rule: you are part of the problem, because either you're being paid, right? How meager it might be, because everyone's broke. That's a fact of life.
He's referring to his fear. Yeah.
which I accept with complete enthusiasm, because I understand the reality of it. And if we all belong to a union, we should belong to the guild with enthusiasm. I accept it's fine. Happy to be here. It's fun. I like it. I like where I come from. This place, Calabas, where I teach, it's sort of like a cousin of the AA in a weird way. Right? But I'm trying to find a way to take. For example, I do a lot of work on fact and fiction. I'm asked sometimes just to lie. And in fact, in one of my books, The Vatican in Vegas, the one that you mentioned, I put in one false footnote. It's about an allegory written in the 1890s where blindness is treated as a labyrinth. And the editor of Frankfurt Allgemeine, Peter Hertheim, his name is, he called me up on the phone when they used to do that. They text message across the street. Hello, I see you. You see? And he said, oh, I've been spending 2 days in the library. I'm tracking it down, that mysterious German allegory. And I said to him, but did you look at the footnote? He said, what do you mean? He said, in the footnote, I explained in honor of Edgar Allan Poe, it's a hoax. Because it's a book about special effects. I thought I should try a special effect. And then I heard this rustling of pages, which you hear sometimes, and there's a certain sound that Germans make, that kind of a, it's a sound, I don't know how to explain it, but it's a sound like, oh shit, right, basically. And I it was just interesting, because I was curious to see, do people actually read footnotes? You know, now I know, they don't, right? So in playing with fact and fiction, I've also become very aware of how often fact and fiction are. The character I talk about, his name is Harry Brown, and he lives with me and me, and I ask him questions every so often, because I know Harry will have a really good answer, because Harry is an expert on espionage. So I ask him questions like, how did you get your work done? And he says, all the time, he says, don't you understand that fiction is always more believable than fact. And because fiction is always more believable than fact, you can always get around it.
And I thought, Harry's right. You know, and I'm then various developing research, and it's just that there's an area of sociology that, I mean, you look at Durkheim's work on anomie, and I mean, what a strange thing. He's studying suicide to understand how people behave. I mean, I've met people who are suicidal. I don't know if they're really a good way to measure how everyone behaves, and yet it's magnificent, isn't it, right? And so so I guess I would not so much defend it, but argue that the literary aspect of a deep scholarly investigation of what's true and not true, and how these facts and fictions coordinate, especially in an era like ours, is as worthy as any other.
Who else has lost on this, you think? Sloterdijk, perhaps?
Oh, I read Sloterdijk. No, I don't think so. We had a long dinner. He made fish with onions and went on, and so his library and so on. And there is one historian from the 1930s. The Annales School has always interested me for that. I think because it's so precise, but I don't know how to pronounce it properly, I have a feeling I say, but it's Huizinga, Johan Huizinga. Huizinga?
And Huizinga, yeah.
And it's interpreted. The translation is the waning of the Middle Ages, or it might be closer to the order of the Middle Ages. And it's an extraordinary book, and he did another book on the ludic play. Mm-hmm. And I think he really was trying to capture the ironies of morbidity and the ironies of collective play and how it could actually reach to other levels of collective action.
Can I just chip in?
He's asking very big questions. I know. He's asking really big questions.
Well, the question seems to be around method, and yes. You know, I'm not sure there's free association. I think there's something quite particular to what you do, which seems to be focused around a kind of spatial sensibility, and yes. I suppose this notion comes out of the book that we've all been mentioning, this Vatican to Baker's The History of Special Effects, where you've coined this term scripted space.
Yes.
And in a way, this, without saying this kind of narrative around entropy, for example, without saying the word spatial is
spatial from the kind of movements you make, yes. And its relationship to, as you say, the relationship to thinking about kind of future cities and the tools. And the city, and the city of Paris. So, yeah, I mean.
Luckily, he wasn't grabbed. And he was grabbed also in the 70s, most seriously. So I may have to bring him.
This kind of approach gives us the tools with which to think about the sort of future city that we might wish to inhabit.
Yes.
Now, you kind of made that claim, but you don't necessarily assert it. And I just wonder, maybe you could elaborate a little bit. Well, how we apply these tools to that kind of thinking.
Yeah. One is how it's adapted. Oh, I hate to use the word organically because it's such a phony expression. But we understand we don't have terms like it. So if we have to put it in quotes, right? To save time, that there is a kind of almost collective, unconscious way that cities are adapted by people living in a certain place. In other words, there's, let's say, a footprint left from buildings that were torn down, or something was gone, or something wasn't finished, and yet they are adapted in certain ways. Sometimes immigration, the ethnographic adaptations are amazing. So we have that aspect of how a city is, shall we say, anthropologically altered by the people in it, and then eventually other things are added, other buildings match, right?
And then we have, obviously, the urban planners and all the corruptions that go with that, because they're almost always in bed with somebody. It seems like the urban planning world is a form of patronage, and that's weird, right? And you want to say it's not true, but and the hearts are in the right place, but the hearts aren't as close to their pockets, right? Oh, my heart's in the right place, but. And then you have other kinds of events, economic events that intrude. For example, in Los Angeles, which I know very well, right? That's true. I sort of like half own the place, but it gives me nothing back, except bad traffic, you know. But in Los Angeles became very wealthy for various reasons, but one aspect though that provided an enormous amount of labor was government contracts to build weapons. It started in the Second World War, basically, and they became the largest aerospace city area. It was a whole region. You know, LA is a big region. Then they lost it all during the end of the Cold War, and they went into recession. Then a curious thing happened. At the same time went through recession, their harbors started to grow. The harbor trade, because of China. Finally now, 40% of everything coming into the United States and 40% of everything from China comes through those two ports. Then gradually they built a special train line and freight line system for trucks down one corner, another corner, and now the entire region has been rewired economically around the harbors up to 70 miles wide. So one has to say, wow, this is a big urban issue. I mean, the jobs are in different places, the nature of things are in different places, and then there's also the nature of the job economy itself, which is, I think, part of why these little neighborhoods are becoming like townships, because a lot of people in this gig economy situation are there, even if they have to pay 3,000 euros a month, 3,000 pounds a month to live in some little dumpy apartment. They'll do that even if it's 75% of the income. So I'm all these factors together. So the first thing is to see which factor dominates. And then there's another factor now that troubles me and confuses me. I see young women, for example, or young men or whatever, but let's say three women walking across the street text messaging while a bus is going at them at 60 miles an hour or something, you know, 50 miles an hour. Yeah. Your eyes are lighting up. You feel it's like one of those intercut scenes in a movie where you, oh no, it's too late. And then just as the truck or bus comes near them, they do this strange thing like a bullfighter. They somehow know, even though they're looking down there, that object is hurtling at them. And then you think, gee, the whole way people are inhabiting the streets is starting to change. How will that have to be adjusted to urban planning? They're building parklets in Los Angeles. They're all disgusting. They're little places where you can text message, you know, and they're hideous. It's a mistake, but I understand why, right? Then there's also ecological issues. The water issues are different everywhere. So it depends on which one dominates, right? But I think what's happening now is that cities are, like London, are in a very different place than the cities like Chicago. Like, for example, I mean, London is a crossroads city because of the nature of its banking. LA is a crossroads city for any number of reasons, meaning it crosses continents. And these crossroads cities have become generally coastal, but Dubai is sort of different, you know, because of the other ways that they have to deliver and move around. They have tremendous immigration hubs. They're like free cities in the 15th centuries. They're like Hansa cities. They're like little kingdoms, and they're developing a sovereignty all on their own, and that's really strange. They're being modeled around a new system of sovereignty, and that's what's really fascinating me about cities now. They're becoming sovereign kingdoms with tremendous levels of inequality that are almost unworkable, and the amount of capital that flows through them is
is ridiculous, and then they become havens for Russian oligarchs to buy an apartment for, I don't know, £5 million or whatever it is. So I don't know which one dominates, but I'd like something more human to happen. I don't know of any city that knows how to cope with this properly. I think New York has lost it. I think it missed it. I think London has a tremendous problem trying to cope with it. Los Angeles, it's a little earlier, and they might do better because they've been such a mess, you know. But I really think that something very powerful has to be done. The cities have to be reimagined if they're going to be these kingdoms. So I'm thoroughly engrossed with how, from a neighborhood issue, right, how people cross the street, so to speak, and then also another issue is the end of the automobile as a dominant model for circulation in cities. So cities that don't need automobiles like Amsterdam, I guess they can act superior, but that's just lucky, right? London has this weird problem that it has too many little horse trails left for some reason. They didn't do what they did in Paris. You know what I mean? So every city has different issues, but that means cities are returning to what they looked like in 1910 in their footprint before the auto came. I think that's fantastically interesting. So you have to look at where you were before the auto took over and bring that back. Oh, I think this is a great moment for urban planning. But it's just like this feudalistic entropic business. It's very granular and layered and more than usual. And at the same time, cities are becoming very, very autocratic at the top in many cases because they have so much power. So I think it's we could easily have a week-long discussion just how to take this problem to the level of urban planning. And then architects are being asked to retrofit buildings all the time. That used to be an insult, right? That they said, can you fix this building? But don't knock it down. You cannot knock this building down. I said, give us a plan. And we have so much infrastructure left in the misery because mid-century modernism doesn't work anymore in a lot of cases. We have all these horribly big, lumpy cement things, and we don't know what to do with them. We can't make a high line out of everything, right? We can't just put little parks on top of everything. I'll put a park on. It's not enough. But at the same time, it's fascinating. So, well, we have a kind of Gothic revival fascination with the city before the automobile dominated. We have a new version of urban life and power, and we have this tremendous, tremendous crisis about labor, which is not going to go away. And I don't know, if countries can't handle it, then cities will have to do it. How does a city handle the labor problems like London? How's London going to do it? So I think urban planners are being asked to be, shall we say, very fanciful and not as scientific as they used to be. The human issues are beginning to really interfere. And I think it could be a great era for urban studies. And hopefully a great era for cities. Yes. Yeah, the other thing, yeah. Yeah, I know. I mean, these people coming from Berlin to talk to me, they only handle startups in Berlin. That's a new thing, I guess, in Berlin. Startups, everyone talks about startups. So yes, this does affect how... Anyway, are there other... You've been very patient listening to all of the elders in the room, you know, having their say. But the idea was that you're supposed to be talking also. So are there questions or issues, observations? I mean, it's a very straightforward argument in one way, right? That we have a new political economy that has come of age, but it's not a system, it's a condition. And the condition is beginning to really, really fracture, make tremendous tears. In Western countries too.
Okay.
That's it?
I think age has deprived you, as it has me, of being able to distinguish between a student and a teacher.
Thank you. That's really nice to see you taking us as
two. I feel a problem in college. You're architects, right? You've got some serious things to do.
Serious stuff, yeah.
in universities, young lecturers are just awful people. And they've all been kind of done over by the system. So they're all talking about.
welcome back.